Sam.
Sure.
And now submitted by Rick Von Williams, Vibration English Folk Song.
Yeah, called Fear Trailblazers and Users of Steel Developing in Los Angeles House. If we look at Notre Steel Frame and the Lovell House and then the progressive work that Rafael Soriano did. And then I would say Pierre Koenig is definitely a third generation in that illustrious lineup. He actually built his first steel house in 1950 when he was still in college. And he did two of the case study houses, number 21 and 22. And when 21 was completed, John Antenza was very pleased. He thought that it contained, in his words, some of the cleanest and most immaculate thinking in the development of a small contemporary house. Pierre Koenig was born in San Francisco. He's a graduate of the USC School of Architecture. He worked in Soriano's office for several months when he was a young man, and he started his practice of architecture in 1954. He also taught at USC since the early 1960s. And his work has been awarded and published both nationally and internationally. And his case study house 22, which he did in 1959 with the 10-foot cantilevered living room, which certainly was published all over the world, became the image that is now synonymous with the case study house program, and was chosen to be reconstructed at the recent exhibit at MoCA, which I hope you all saw. When Esther McCoy wrote about Pierre Koenig in her case study house book, she quoted him saying, "Steel is not something you can take up and put down. It is a way of life." And tonight he will be sharing that way of life with us. Gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce to you Pierre Koenig.
Can you hear me without the microphone? I want to thank Shelley and all of you for inviting me tonight. It's a pleasure to be able to show you some of my work. You know, when I started in the school in about 1948 after World War II was over. It was a very exciting period of time to be in because of the excitement of designing new buildings and the effort to produce mass-produced houses. And I must say that the origin of modern architecture, the Rick-Paulson Greenhouse, at least had its origins in Southern California, because of the tremendous effort that Shelley talked about, Richard Neutra and Soriano, and a lot of other people. But the wooden post and beam really got its start in Southern California immediately after the war, and really took over the style, at least as taught at USC, which at that time was the only school of architecture in Southern California. The other school was in Berkeley, and at the time that USC had converted from the Beaux-Arts system to the new five-year program, Berkeley hadn't yet changed from Beaux-Arts. So in a sense, it was only SC that was doing modern architecture, so it was quite natural that it came from there. Now, the one person who really made the post and beam glass, sliding glass, well, it wasn't sliding glass doors then, but glass house, was Gordon Drake. And he was an industrial design student at USC. And he had dreamed about his house all through the war, and he got out. He had a couple of years more to go to school. And during that time, he built this house, which when photographed, was exhibited throughout the whole United States, and everybody immediately started doing this kind of work. It had French doors. There was no such thing as glass door then, sliding glass door then. And the living room extended out on the same plane into a lovely patio surrounded by oak trees. And it's quite beautiful. And shortly thereafter, Garden was killed, steamed by an avalanche. So that was the end of that. But the whole school took up this kind of work. And while I was there, it occurred to me that really, the original origin of the Boston Beam House stems way back to Chicago in 1890, and then later on the Bauhaus in Germany to some extent. And it was the Boston Beam with glass is really meant to be a steel frame, not a wood frame. Why not, at least? So I started working on that school. It was very unpopular. My instructors didn't like that at all. And I had a hard time getting through. But the more they said you can't do it, the reasons why you can't do it, the same reasons you hear today. It's too expensive. People wouldn't like it. Housewives wouldn't like it. It's ugly. Whoever heard about housewives, blah, 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 blah. So the more they said this, the more I wanted to do one. So I bought a lot. And tax sale and borrowed $5,000. My parents still signed the loan and I designed a steel house. Well, I was very, very green behind the ears, and first one I designed, of course, the budget came out $10,000 or $12,000. I said, well, something's wrong here. And so I started going to all the steel companies, the glass companies, door people to find out. They invented a steel sliding glass door, but a steel bill. And I learned a lot about how to design steel glass. And in the meantime, then, I had contacted Suriano, and I told him what I was doing, and he was interested in what I was doing. So we got together, and I did a lot of the carving through the renderings, which you see some of the exhibits. And as I worked, I realized that it was getting pretty close to what Suriano was doing. But I tell you, you know, he had an economics down, and I had two choices. I either had to change my style, so I wouldn't be like Suriano at all, and it would be more expensive, and I wouldn't get my house. So I continued to grab how it's going. And I used some of the same parts he did, but of course in a lot different way. Suriano was a pioneer, but that was so early on that he covered everything up, as you know, he didn't expose any of his work. And, I didn't see anything wrong with the appearance of exposed steel decking. And matter of fact, it had a lot of attributes. So I went ahead and did it that way and innovated a lot of different things. It sort of went on from there. And I got the house for $5,000, which I'm going to show you in a minute. And plus a little labor and all. So it's about the going rate of any house at that time. So when I graduated in 52, I already had commissions waiting for me. And so I did more and more from that point on. Now we'll see if I can start the slideshow here. And get everything. Let's see. Lot was in Glendale, and amongst a lot of oak trees, very dark and sunshine very seldom. So it was necessary to bring in a lot of light. Then I had more commissions from that one, and did a lot of work in the Sun Valley, Cahunga, La Cañada area, and in Glendale. This is another one using the same structural system and the same concept as the first house you saw, but a bigger size. The idea seemed to be a good one, and it offered a lot of the amenities that Southern California has since been known for. We seem to be losing some of that now, but the main thrust of modern architecture in Southern California was in the beginning take advantage of the outdoors and the lovely weather, and introduce the slab, or at least make it popular, where you could extend the interior of the house to the exterior with glass doors, very important. And really take advantage of everything. The houses were well insulated. John McKenzie always told me, he said, no matter how beautiful these houses are, they're uncomfortable for people to live in, or they're not going to be popular. So you must make sure that they're not cold in the winter nor too hot in the summer. So all of us were very particular about that. They had pretty good insulation on the roof, on top of the steel deck, and in the walls. Pretty much about what the law requires you to do now. But in those days, we didn't really need the law to tell us what to do. Some of the architects even used black steel or concrete slabs back in the early 60s to radiate heat out at night. And then, of course, we oriented the size of the elevations with the glass in such a way that they would receive the sun in the wintertime and not in the hot summertime. There was ample cross ventilation due to the large sliding glass doors, which kept you cool in the summer. So we're doing a lot of things that you can't see, but they're there nevertheless. The slide on the left is how the house looks today, and on the right how it was then. This is another one, La Cañada. I just finished putting on a designing an addition for that one. We're doing a lot of that work lately. Some of the people have been there for years, the families have grown, and they don't want to move, so I've added on to the houses and get into that a little bit more, which is kind of a fun problem to do. You got to remember, the people say, well, gee whiz, all these houses at the show, the Mocha show, are so small. Well, people forget what it was like in the 50s, the 40s and 50s. The standard home was 2 bedrooms and 1 bath. They're all that way. There were one, in those days, there were 1-bedroom homes and 1 bath. It wasn't unique. The 3-bedroom home was an mansion most of the time. Times have changed, and it's hard to visualize task in terms of our own values. Scholars are always interpreting the past in terms of present values, and I know from just my experience it's not always true, but it's not that simple. You can't make those kinds of connections based on what we do now, because it's different then. We didn't have the communication, we didn't know all the things that you know now. The scholars point and say, well, it's so-and-so, but in those days there wasn't any so-and-so. We're talking about people that you never heard of, Lee Klein, A.C. Martin. I mean, these were the architects, Frank Lloyd Wright. And sure, we knew about Mies van der Rohe, we knew about the Barcelona Pavilion, that was about it. There was one book on Mies that big, the whole library, USA. And certainly nobody wanted to talk about them. Yep. So Frank Lloyd Wright was the big thing then. And things were just different. And Eames into his house till 1950, the same time I did that, did mine. Farnsworth House, the Mason Dunbar House in the United States was 1950. So see, there's nothing. There was a big gray area in there. And the only thing we had was hopes and dreams. Nothing, no background. Today in school, at least my school, I don't know about the others, they say, well, what's the historical background? What's the historical background for what you're doing? Well, you know, so what? We didn't have a historical background. I mean, it was nothing there. And unless you went back to the Gothic, you know, and everybody hated the shingle roof thing and shutters and the banks were only making loans on houses that had shutters and shingle roofs. And, you know, it was a whole different world. So these things are quite remarkable, I think, in terms of how hard it was. I had to go out and actually procure loans from my clients to get the money so the clients could build these. I can remember back in the late 68, the $10 extra charge was significant. You don't realize that the house building costs have gone up 400% since 1960. It's a whole different world. The price of a house is here that costs $15,000. And it went like that, remember, up until inflation hit us about 72. 72 was a break-off point. Everything changed then. It changed architecture as well as the money system. Our money is, you know, doesn't mean that much as it to people as it did then. We're in a period of inflation, but the value of the dollar, not the monetary value, but our value, what we value the dollar is a lot less than it was then. And these kinds of values were more important. Today, the dollar value means that, well, it's not what goes into the house, but what goes on the house. That's what's important. I don't know how this Neutra and Suriano, these people ever got to build those houses when they did, because in the 40s and 50s it was almost virtually impossible to build a modern house then. So they must have really suffered a lot or had some very wealthy clients that didn't have to worry about anything.
Who did finance those houses if banks wouldn't touch them?
I think they probably had many people.
But I mean the houses you're talking about.
Well, these, my clients, and most of the clients, I guess, do modern houses then and now, are professional people. They're scientists, doctors. It's interesting because it's a cycle. And aerospace scientists were big. They're the big thing. I had a lot of clients. They were designing rockets and things. And they're out now, and it's engineers and people, professional people. Unusual people, really. I mean, people that really, really wanted something different. And they weren't willing to accept the easy route to buy something and build it. And, you know, it's not easy to go out and build something, buy the lot, and go through plans and build a car and borrow the money and all the hassle. Of course, after they're done, they have something in there. They're happy about it. This house, you can see this is up in Tahunga, and I think you can see the heat when you look out there. This is desert, and I have two of them up there, and it gets real, as you know, really hot, and no air conditioning in any of these houses. A lot of people live in Tahunga because of the health, a healthy place to live, they can't have air conditioning because it's bad for their health. But I learned that you can drop the temperature inside the house on the human body, if you wear proper clothing, as much as 10 degrees by natural ventilation. And they have good natural ventilation, and so you can bring it down 10 degrees, and any more than that, it's not healthy for you anyway. So it worked out pretty well. And since then, I mean, I stumbled on that. Since then, I've been working in formalizing those theories and proving them mathematically in the lab, and they're all quite valid. Let's see what I am here. Okay, then up, this is all through the 50s. Then 58, John Intenza had always told me that. He said, Pierre, if you get a good client, come to me and we'll make it a case study house. Well, all my clients are good clients and their houses are all good. So the next one came up, I said, I got one. He said, fine. Looked at it, said, I like it. Do it. So he said, he gave number 21. And I really had a chance to utilize some ideas that I've been, working on for some time. Mm-hmm. And they are, for example, a discrete plan, which means that the interior walls don't touch the outside wall except for where the deposit touches the wall. Remind me of if I look at my pointer. Every point, you can't be ambiguous. You can't be with a conventional stone stucco house. You have to be precise in everything you do. That's one of the reasons why you don't see too many of them around. So, you know, understand that these all of my work, in the main, not everything, but a lot of it, has to do a purpose. One is to satisfy the needs of the client, and the other is to produce a prototype that could go into production system at any given time and be able to generate changes in planning and law with constant structural systems. So each building idea is a kind of experiment for the prototype. So these kinds of things are important. We see them walk around here, and this touches right here, and the rooms form the walls. There are no walls that aren't doing something, and everything is storage. There are no bathroom windows on the outside, which I can test very much. I don't like the looks of them on the outside of the building. So this opens inward. There's a hole in the roof here. It gets a legal light and air from the center. There are two details on the house, one north-south, one east-west. Completely closed on the east, completely closed on the west. Open on the south with sun control screens. And open on the north with no sun control because no sun. And water instead of grass. Water, gravel, brick, hardscape, which is kind of a famous, favorite word now, new code word, hardscape, xeriscape. Xeriscape, where you have waterless lawns. You don't need water scarring. You don't need water. This is a structural shop, and it's all prefabricated. It was prefabricated in a shop in Pasadena and carried out to the site and erected in one day. Which is pretty much the way all of these are done, except they don't have good pictures. That's the other thing, you didn't have a camera in those days, you know. There was only one 35 millimeter slide, the camera. That was a Leica. Who could afford that? I mean, that was $1,000. And then later, exactly, and then later on it became popular, and we all bought cameras. So, you know, that's another problem. So I didn't have a lot of pictures in the beginning. Gives you an idea how things were then. And on your right, there's some of the renderings for the magazine, Arts and Architecture. The you may know by now, the case study house story, how it went. And we published the drawings of the building for a period of about a year, every other month in the magazine. Then on your left, that is a coal tar application rust-proofing on the steel, which over the years has proven to be excellent. And I've gone back again, and I'm using them now because after 25 years, I could see that it's a good product. So you'll see that occurring again and again and again. Remembering on the right, and the black you see was the trim color, and to get away from hand painting, all these are spray painted, that's the only way to go. But to get a trim color, then I mask the black and then spray the whole building white and then pull the masking off and it's left the black charcoal, actually it's charcoal trim color, and that's rid of that coal tar you see. Base paint. It's a base. It's no longer coal tar. It's coal, coal tar derivative. So it gave us a trim. I've learned how to prefabricate everything except the slab concrete footing. There's a rendering pattern on the right. The furniture was designed by myself and Jerry McCabe. You probably think of him as a guitar. He's really a designer, an architectural designer and furniture designer. And his wife, Vicki Stone, is a decorator. We all worked out together. The cabinet is mine, and the rest of the stuff is Terry. Kitchen on the right is a prefab, geometry kitchen. Complete oven. Ovens, range top, dishwasher. It works. Power disposal, everything, it's all in one piece. It's a wonderful idea. Like all wonderful ideas, it disappeared. That's a shot on the left and the interior patio. And some of the xeriscaping. The water is circulated up through the roof by a small pump and then back down again to create it and clean the water because we didn't want to chlorinate it. We don't want to grow plants in it. We want more water in the central patio. This is how the house looks today. We've planted it. The water's still there. The gravel is still there. The plants have taken over. The rest of it. Those are the sunscreens. The water goes under those brick patios. This is As Shelley said, after 21 was successful, John said, want to do another one? I said, sure, why not? So we did 22. I mean, things are pretty hectic. I mean, this was right on the heels of 21. I mean, there's a lot of nights, you know, working. And we produced 22, which is a much larger space. New materials are coming out, and I was able to extend the space is quite a bit and reduce the cost actually. It's a cheaper per square foot house than 21. And the lot is very difficult. All the lots are difficult. I haven't had a good lot since. Well, that's one of the reasons people get an architect. They have a problem. An architect can solve a problem. That's where we shine. And this work, especially given was a problem, it shines. Well, anyway, this is double cantilever. That is to say that the house is anchored back here, someplace back here, and this is cantilevered out on the floor. And there's a column of rests on the concrete cantilever carried back to here. Because the city said all of this slope may give way and fall. If it does, then the house will stay. Like, you know, it's not going to because it's all granite, but city bureaucracy says that's what's in the book, so that's what you do. And of course, you sell this house probably tomorrow. These are the renderings for a study house 22. Changes, you know, occurred from the very beginning, preliminary concept to the actual building of the house. The street side is without any openings. I like to have complete privacy in all my designs, even though there's a lot of glass. It's always looking away from the public. there's a famous shot on the left. And you can see the cameras are actually there. It gives you a very strange feeling to sit out there, of course, floating in space. The pole is on the best part of the lot, because that's the hardest thing to do. It's cool. And the house is mainly on the worst part, because that we can do. The water does this in an earthquake, and it's pretty hard to handle. You have to have a lot of lateral support, more lateral support for the pool than you do.
Can you focus that? Tell me what you're doing.
Thank you. That's the next shot. It's similar to the picture. The cabinets are prefabricated wooden cabinets for those people who like wood and are able to produce, give them wooden prefabricated cabinets. The saving on something like that, again, is labor saving. And they don't need a carpenter to put them together. Fireplace is prefabricated fireplace. You know, before you could buy them, not even buy them, not that big. There's another later on now, another concept, another problem, narrow lot. Entrance on this side, the water pool on this side, the kitchen is here, so come down, actually drive on this part here, come into the center of the house, go to the right, the living room, the left, the bedrooms. This is up in Mendel Canyon. And that's what the house looked like then, which is open to the pool. And the span, now the spans are going to 33 feet, which is a long way. By doing so, I was able to minimize the foundations and were able to build on this lot that had so much fill in it that you couldn't afford the foundations, but with 12 footings, it wasn't so bad. So it worked. You can see how long the spans are here. Then, this is one of those where the people wanted to have a bigger home, family started growing, they didn't want to move. So they call me in to do an addition. You don't put a floor on a steel roof. Your steel roof is a roof. Again, it's very clear. It's not ambiguous. So you have to put a new floor on. There are a lot of other problems. So what I did simply is design and have built a second story house with its own support, its own columns. And took it in a crane, literally placed it over the old house. They didn't even have to move out, except for the entry, which we redid. You wouldn't know that there was an addition going on. On the right is the original, on the left is the new building going over the old. And again, the 33 foot, more than 33 feet, it's bigger than we're for, right? It's a half an inch. It fit, there's a half an inch space between the old and the new. Modern technology. That was then, this is going to be now. And you see the long spans. And you know, one often has second thoughts if you care about your buildings, like we all do. You wonder, you know, what's going to happen to the building if I change it? Should I? Shouldn't I? Well, this came out great. I mean, it really was an improvement, not a detriment. And on the right, this is the old versus new. You really can't tell that this is an old column, this is a new column. They're quite well integrated. But got up there, I was quite surprised to enjoy the in the trees. Because you're down the ground, you're just looking at tree trunks. You don't realize when you get up there, you're looking at the leaves. And it's much better. The new entry. We just cut a hole through the existing entryway and put in a dramatic two-story stairwell. That's glass here on the left. You can't see it, but it's glass. It appears like a we're able to do a lot of new things, ceiling inserts. Instead of having exposed decking here, we have plastic strips in and improved lighting. It really looks quite nice in glass and that's the finished product on the right. And no balcony rails. I didn't want any attention. This is an all-glass building, more glass than I usually use, but there's an opportunity here because on top of the hill in Palos Verdes with no one around to look in, except for Catalina Island, and it's pretty far away. Street planning for the bathrooms and kitchen form of the vision from the bedroom and the living part of the house. This is an imprecise pool. The laundry is out detached from the main house, which they like very much because of noises and the odors away from the building. The long driveway parked here, you can see here. It's zoned. This large area on the left is zoned into the music room, sitting room, and breakfast room. And on the right, there are no overhangs for sun protection, so there's sunscreen. It's on the south and the west. They're really more efficient than overhangs, but a lot of people don't like to have screens, even though it's a very foggy film in front of you. It doesn't bother me very much, but some people object to that. Some people object to even fly screens. A lot of houses just pull fly screens off, put them in the park for because they don't want them up. So, but anyway, where they don't mind them, then it's much better because you control the heat and coolness that way. That's Catalina from on the left, way off the question. Can you see that? And the houses are very neutral. I think Case Study House 22 is successful because it relates to the landscape environment. It's not saying, you know, look at me and make a spectacle of itself. It's very neutral, it fits in, and that's why I think people, well, I know the owners like it, because you're looking at the surrounding of the house. And the buildings take on the characteristics of the environment. Now this house, for example, is all white with all that glass. It's picking up every innuendo of the outside. When the outside is white, it's white. When it's orange, the house is orange. When it's gray, it's gray. And it reflects then the exterior, and it's constantly changing. And I think personally, I like that, the way of changing colors, right? Through reflected light rather than through light or paint. And extended that notion now to artificial light as well, and at night using colored lights to get color rather than paint. So you can see the mood of the house is very, very moody. It has radiant heat, hot water radiant heat for like a lot of these do, 22 gets 2, which is a very nice way to heat a modern house. A lot of modern houses heat it that way because you can open the glass doors even on a cold day and still feel comfortable because radiant heat is not affected by any of the temperature at all or wind. So you stand the wind, you're radiant heated, you feel quite comfortable. Like going out standing in the sun. It's the same thing. Steel cabinets with plywood fastened to the back of them living room side of the house with sliding glass, sliding doors, solid doors, panels that close off the kitchen. Almost every open plan I've done has had sliding panels to close off the early kitchen, right, in company towns. Never used them. One client has used these panels, so I stopped installing them. And at night, at dusk. And the only time you can see in the house is where the light inside and dark outside, the screens and the curtains pulled away. On the left is a on the left and the right is the kind of interesting house. I'm surprised the plants aren't here. They've come to every talk I've ever done for the last 15 years. It's interesting because it's, after I got almost all done with the plans, the bid and everything, I had to get a grading printer. I went down to the geology department. And I was waiting for the man to get something. He was gone for a long time. I started looking through the papers here on the desk. I found out this was an active slider. We had a geology report and paid a lot of money for this geologist who's still around. And I told the clients that they had no problem. We have to redesign the footings. And they got very upset. I mean, it's like $5,000 extra. And we had a big thing to do. And finally, we solved that. I want to get into it. But I paid for a lot of the lectures on this thing. And I told them it's dangerous and all that. And they said, well, like everybody else said, it can't be dangerous because that house next door has been there for 40 years, and the other side for 40 years, and they just built a 100-unit apartment house right below us with two swimming pools and six tennis courts. What are you talking about, danger? I said, well, I'm sorry, but I'm not good. So we went ahead and we redesigned the footings to hold up the hill and everything. They're in the house 1 year. The whole hill came down. Everything except this house. The 40 house had been there for 40 years. That house had been there for 45 years. The 100-unit apartment house, the six tennis courts and the two pools all went down the intersection of Pacific Coast Highway and Sunset Boulevard. So all that, you know, hassle and everything, and not even a thank you very much goodbye or anything. But that's a good lesson, you know. It's like, and do things right. So $5,000 means nothing today. Your life and your property here. We're talking about. That's at the Upper Least. You can go there now. It's on the Bella Drive. You can see it if you want. They're very nice people. They'll let you in. They're very proud of the house. But right next door is this chasm, the valley. They have the sewer line hanging on a bridge that goes across the void. Still nothing there. So you can go see it for yourself. And that's from the lower side looking up. No more balconies. It has an 18-inch window washing balcony. I found out that 4-foot balconies are not useful for anything very expensive. They don't produce anything. So I took the space and gave it to a room, space out of a breakfast meeting room here, which you put a table and chairs, and another one off the living room down here. Make it useful. I'm trying to do that ever since. This is the entry on the left. There you can see the window washing rail. Pipe rail, very economical, very popular postmodern guy today. It's a thing now, it's an artistic form. That's from the view from their kitchen. It's all new down there, it's front there now. So, new buildings. You come in at this very large entry with skylights, and you walk down this central hall into the living room below. It's kind of an upside-down plan. Prefabricated fireplace. It's huge, 6 feet, so then you wouldn't have to cut logs too small. This is a house up in northern San Francisco Bay, bachelor pad. no paint, all natural materials for these steel. This is a knockdown exhibit I did for the Craftsman Steel. The steel companies at the higher level did nothing for us during all this. Lower level fellows are pretty good. They tried to support us and all this, knowing it would benefit them in the long run, but nothing much happened. I did get this job from them. They had a traveling exhibit building that was just awful, got awful. We decided to redo it. And this is a package deal that the knocks down, it fits in a wooden crate that's 6 inches deep, four or eight feet wide, and 20 feet long. And pull all this out of the package, put it together, lights are all there, exhibit is there, all you do is plug it in. And when it goes around all the home shelves and fairs and things like that. This is one of the many jobs I did with the late Dr. Robert Allen Franklin. And it's a restaurant in Thousand Oaks. And he wanted 160-foot spans in the restaurant. I did it like with tricky geometry, 80-foot spans, like 80-foot spacing, I get 160 feet out of it. By hand labor, just presses that on this side. Left is the medical building, on the right is the restaurant, quite large, all naturally cool on top of the mountain with sliding and openable glass all around the periphery and then at the roof. Even though it was only to be used at night, what people don't realize is that a building like a restaurant heats up during the day. And then when the restaurant opens at 6, they blast the air conditioning on for an hour or two. Really make it cold, cool it down to all that heat. So by keeping the temperature down low all day long when it was open at night, then you only had to lower the temperature 2 degrees as opposed to maybe 20, 30, 40 degrees. So it was useful even then. This is a tree, what I call a tree structure, or a concrete frame with individual buildings set on the floors, with separation between them. We'll get into that a little later when I show you another building. This is a mosque, an Islamic mosque, that is a prefabricated, pre-stressed concrete building, which was never built because they were fighting amongst themselves so much. Never got built. This is a pole house, a true pole house. You don't see too many of them. We did some research on it, couldn't find any. There was one that burned down. What this is, the man is building with, now we're getting out of the loan period, right? People are going to have money. Yeah, but not that much. So we're building cash, but he couldn't afford the whole thing. So every time he got some money, he built one of these units. We actually built two, and then we prepared for these two. This is the living room kitchen module. This is the entertainment guest house module. This is a studio, another bedroom module. This is the master bedroom, bathroom, suite. They're all the same, which cuts again, even the wood, it cuts down on the cost. I mean, produce a lot of the same things over and over and over again, but use them in different ways. You can produce variation with savings of multiple production. With wood, you're not going to achieve the moment bracing connections, and steel. So we had to do it in a different way, and that's why you see the cross bracing here. And that supports the lower floor. To give us a cantilever up above the floor four to the living quarters, because neither the client nor I wanted to have anything hinging our view as we look out. And you know, the steel houses, The glass is always unobstructed. The only thing you have is vision of a 4-inch panel. And that's very important. It's important to me, and it's been important to my clients, and it's been important to a lot of people over the centuries. For instance, the Japanese have known this for hundreds of years, that when you look out, extend the outside end, you can't have anything there except the most minimal kind of structure. And all the planes carry the eye through perspective to encompass the outside. So in order to do it with wood, it's really hard to do. And by cantilevering up this way with the poles, we're able to achieve that. So there are multiple problems when you deal with these buildings like this. They're all fun to solve. And try to make everything come out just right. There are little transition areas between the constant modules that fit between, which are also stairs that go up and then either left or right. They're closed. You can move from one to the other undercover. The technique is similar to that of steel, that is to say it has to be prepared off-site and then brought in, ready to go, put up. In this case, simply because the poles have to be treated. Well, in the first place, they're not telephone poles, as we think they are. They're architectural poles. They're much nicer than telephone poles. They're prepared, treated, and all that, cut, trimmed out, and brought to the side. Okay, same on the left. This is what I'm talking about. The extension of the eye through the spring here. The floor will carry you out, and the roof line all to the view. There's no sheer wall like ordinarily a wooden house. We have to have a sheer wall here, at least 4 feet. And some conventional buildings, for some reason, escapes me. Even if they don't need it, they'll put a little return. It's called a return in building terms. Why they do that? I don't know, because it kills it. It kills the extension of this plane out. It stops here and stops here. But they do it. I don't know. I guess they feel they can't fit something in here. Well, there's no reason why you can't fit something in there. We don't wait until it's there. We do it ahead of time and it comes out and it fits. It just takes a little caring to do that kind of thing. So it can be done. And this is about done. All right, now that's one reel. I have one more. We have about 25 minutes more. I'm going to take a break as I go right into the second one. Might as well go ahead and finish this off. Yeah. Well, some is 5 days. No, 5 days.
Are you okay to the end of this next carousel?
Yes.
Okay.
I'll change. Problem that I kind of invented myself, made a solution for it, and that is to solve the problem of how the builder can get involved with these modern houses. So I've designed and built a steel tree, and on each floor is a conventional wooden structural frame house, and completely independent. They were built on the steel frame, but one could visualize taking a derrick and lifting them up and stamping them on the frame. The redundancy wasn't, it's quite large, 1,000 square feet. It was up until the time they built the New City Hall, it was the largest building in Monterey Park. Bottom floor, that's on the right is the pool house and garage. The top floor is on the left. Metal floor on the right. There's a sun control screen because the orientation is east to west. Very difficult. I had no choice here. So I had to use the vertical planes, which worked up till about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. There's a construction shot on the right. You can clearly see the, looks like an airplane, a Wright Brothers airplane. coming. You can see the wood construction of the steel frame. There are only 6 columns holding the whole thing up. But there are a lot of advantages to it. There are a lot of advantages to that. The separation between the floors is good if they have a big family, which they do, but the sounds don't carry at all. And the other thing is that you can get in between the floors. It's about 4 feet, 3 or 4 feet between them. You get in there and it changes any time quite easily. Monterey Park, yeah. Up on top of the mountain, quite a nice site. There's some lovely homes up there, all architect design.
Out.
in that four ways. And you can see what we're up against here. And probably it makes 22 look rather conservative. We've been getting good at that over the years. And the other problem with, one of the many problems with this is you have no place to store materials. You don't park the truck temporarily. There's no street, there's nothing. So you have to bring everything on the site and ready made and you put it in the door right away. 82, 83, early 80s. You bring it up right up to the day. That picture on the right is the street. They made us design a retaining wall all up the street, so narrow, one lane, brick street. And that's city property. Everything you see in that slide there, that's a road. You have to put a bridge over that road to get to the house. And see that? There's the house out there. Love to be new to that. I'm looking out, a lot of people just don't. They really, you know, they scrambled. If the house is rented, the owner decided that this wasn't spectacular, you know, sitting in all the facts. A lot of Hollywood type people need to get them on the folks. They fight over, I mean, literally, they scramble and scratch and everything to get in, but get a lease or. Well, that's looking from below. Somebody said it like all the sculptures. An engineer must have a fit when he came out there and saw the actual site. He went back to their office and checked all his figures. It's one thing, you know, to work on a piece of paper, and another thing, see it in real life. That's the hammock is out on the street in the city complex. The radio station, yeah. You know, a lot of the shopping center, another house. Oh, it's going on right now, along the left.